three.
Yeah. And if it does, then it
works.
Information in the student handbook, so the subject selection handbook, to which there is an electronic link, so that's an iNewsletter link. So all of that information is available through MyGSG, and if we don't answer, like I will come to you and get questions from you in a little while, if we don't answer those tonight, please let me know at the end and we'll link you up with your child's head of house to make sure that we get through all of that. So I'm going to skip through these first few slides and start really with the one that talks about the people who are here to help you with this decision-making process. And I suppose really to start with the message that we are trying at this point to get students to make a decision about whether they are university bound or whether they are vocational workplace bound, and that's the decision that we're trying to get to just at this point. There's lots of levels of complexity. For some of you, you've been here and done this and this is your second turn at all of this, and for some of you it's the first time and we want to make sure that you're comfortable with that decision making. So with me tonight, Mark Bonham, who's our head of senior school, Victoria Turner, who's our head of teaching staff operations, but as far as I'm concerned, the timetable is very much about supporting students through this process, as is Angela Ferreira, and Angela is our Vet and Careers Coordinator, and Angela is also a really important link in this chain, if you like, in terms of supporting your children. You'll have to bear with me because I'm looking at what you're seeing in reverse in the screen in front of me. So you have all of those details. All of the students will finish with a WACE, a WA Certificate of Education, and that is overseen by the School Curriculum and Standards Authority. They will receive a WASA. For those of you who haven't been through this journey before, welcome to death by acronym. There are an awful lot of acronyms, all of which are explained in the handbook that you will have had access to. So all students receive those, and it is all overseen by the School Curriculum and Standards Authority, to whom we report in this process. So if we come to the guts of what we're trying to do with students, we are trying to get to helping them make a decision about whether they want to pursue a path that is the most direct way to get to university, and the ATAR, the Australian Tertiary Admissions Rank, which is what that stands for, is really just a way for universities to identify students who would like to go to a university and which university course they would like to do. So this is the most direct pathway, but there are other pathways in terms of getting to university, and this is the decision that we want to make at this point. So here at Great Southern Grammar, If students are choosing an ATAR pathway, they will be doing at least 5 ATAR courses, and that's in Year 11 and in Year 12. So what we are saying to students is, if you are pursuing this pathway, this is what we want you to be doing. And the reason for that is that we have a lot of data that shows for students who pursue fewer than 5 ATAR courses, their results are not giving them the purpose for which they're pursuing the ATAR pathway in the first place, which is entrance to university. So we've got lots of data that says for students who do fewer than 5, they end up with an ATAR that is of no use to them in terms of getting into the course that they want to get into. They'll get an ATAR, but a lot of them end up with an ATAR. But in previously, kids have ended up with an ATAR of 30 or 40, which is not helpful in terms of getting into a course at university. So that's one of the pathways. The other pathway is the general pathway, and or VET. So VET is vocational education and training. And this is for students who would like to pursue study at TAFE, or they would like to go into the workforce once they've finished school. And there are a range of super fantastic options for students in this pathway. And that's really a matter of us making sure that we are matching the requirements of your child and their interests and passions to where they're going in the longer term. So we'll talk a little bit about that. But what we suggest to students is that if they are pursuing a VET general pathway, that they do an English, a maths, so maths general, English general, and that they do careers and enterprise general, which is a fantastic course that sets them up either for further study or for the workplace. And then on top of that, that they start to pull in certificate courses or general courses. And part of the requirement for students to finish in order to achieve that WACE is that they either finish with a certificate 2 or higher, or they finish with an ATAR, or they finish through doing at least five general courses. So there's those options for students as they go through. So that's what we're trying to get to tonight. I'm just going to keep skipping through, and I'll just talk very briefly about these breadth and depth requirements. So students must complete, and we're talking about semesters here, students must complete at least 20 course units. So I spoke to the Year 10s the other day, and we did very hard maths. We said if you do 6 courses, regardless of whether they're ATAR or VET General, in Year 11, and they are semester 1 and semester 2 courses, how many units do you end up with at the end of the year? And I was delighted that somebody said 12, and I thought, phew. So they will do 12 course units by the time they've finished Year 11. And if they are doing 5 ATAR, they may consider dropping one of those courses in Year 12. But that is only available for students who are doing 5 ATAR courses. So we'll just make that clear. And we have had some questions, which is fantastic, earlier on. But what I'd like to do is try to address some of those by going through this first, and then we'll talk about some of the ins and outs. They must do English. Hooray, say all of the English teachers in the room. And the maths teachers look at their shoes and scowl. So the students must do English all the way through, either literature or English all the way through to the end of Year 12. And so that's dealing with the List A requirement, which is a humanities requirement. And they must do at least 1 maths, science or technology course. So at least 1 what they call List A, and at least 1 what they call List B. And apart from that, they can pursue other courses as their heart desires within some of the other rules that we've got to follow here. They need to do at least 10 course units in Year 11, and only 4 of those can come from VET or courses. So we just need to be balancing out what students are doing as they're making their choices. And the same in Year 12 then. And I've talked a little bit about finishing Year 12 either with a Certificate 2 or an ATAR or 5 general courses. They must also meet the C grade requirement. So of the 20 course units that are compulsory, they'll end up doing more here at Grammar, but of the 20 course units that are compulsory, they must get 14 C grades or higher. And whilst that seems easy on the face of it, what sometimes we find is students who don't make good choices about their courses in Year 11 and aren't achieving well find it then quite difficult to make up that ground through into Year 12. So what we really want to do is make sure that they're on the right pathway as early as possible. And in addition to that, they need to meet the requirements around ULNA, the Online Literacy and Numeracy Assessment, which students can have met by getting a band 8 or higher in their Year 9 NAP plan, okay, which will be a whole other conversation for students from this year who missed out on that plan, but that's not your children. So I'm going to keep scooting through here. The one thing that I do want to make clear is that on an ATAR pathway, students will have to sit examinations, and that's in Year 11 and in Year 12, and they must do those exams in order to complete the course. So it's important that you know that exams are on the radar if your child is doing an ATAR course. If they are choosing to do general courses, they will need to sit in only in Year 12 an EST, so an externally set task that is sent to us from Perth, and that counts for 15% of their grade, but that's sat in school, in their classroom, so it's not like an exam situation. So from here, I'm just going to scoot through so that we've got time to have some questions. Did anyone want to ask any questions at this point? Because I'm really happy. Do just stop me. I'm good at stopping. I'm good at talking, but I'm also good at stopping talking and listening. So feel really free to stop me. What we thought might be helpful is just to show you a few different pathways that students can choose. This student has chosen 6 ATAR courses. It does happen, believe it, contrary to popular opinion, some students do choose 6 ATAR courses. And this student is going to stick with those ATAR courses through Year 11 and into Year 12. The thing I wanted to point out here is this student will also attract a 10% weighting for maths methods. This is the government's way of trying to encourage students to take on the higher level courses. Yeah. Oh, sorry, beg your pardon, I'm sorry. Please keep roaring at me and saying, excuse me, crazy lady. So this student here, beg your pardon, will attract a bonus 10% on top of their ATAR for maths methods, maths specialist, and or for Japanese. So that's Japanese here, it's languages across the state, but for Japanese. And that is regardless of whether those courses are counted in the calculation of their final ATAR. So the ATAR is calculated on the student's top 4 results. So they do 6 courses. The computer says take the top 4 to calculate the ATAR. And a lot of students will ask me, do I have to count English? You've already made me do English. Do I have to count it? And the answer is no. So it's top 4. And even if the student does Japanese, for example, but it doesn't end up in their top 4, they will still get the 10% loading that goes onto the calculation of their ATAR at the end. So that's worth having a discussion with your children if they are considering that. Right, are we looking at the same thing? I think we are. Yes. This student started with 6 ATAR in Year 11 and has decided to drop to 5 ATAR in Year 12 and has picked up a study line. And really all that means is where that on their timetable they had modern history in a day, Monday period 3 and Tuesday period 7 and 8 and Wednesday and so forth, they will be able to do private study. So that's something that is attractive for some students. I very often get questions about, can we have a private study in Year 11? And the answer is no. can we have a private study in year 12 if I do fewer than 5 ATAR? And the answer is also no. So I just want to be really clear about that from the outset. This student is going to do a combination of ATAR and VET, and this is quite a popular choice for many of our students. Our particularly the Certificate 3 Music is a really popular program with the students as they go through. So this student has decided to do, and I'm looking around the room and I can see people's children who are already doing this. This student has decided to do 5 ATAR and a Certificate 2 course. And in this circumstance, it's music. Some students might do a hospitality or might do another type of certificate course through their journey. They could equally do a general course through their journey as well. So many of the students who choose this will stay with that certificate or general course through year 11 and 12. They tend not to drop it in year 12. This is just in this context, but they tend not to drop it if they're starting on that pathway. In terms of VET pathways, there's lots of opportunities for the students. And at the moment, this represents about 35% of our year 11 and 12 students are on a VET or general pathway. And so it's not an uncommon pathway, and it's one that we spend a lot of time, and I'm looking at Angela here, we spend a lot of time supporting students to make sure that their pathway is appropriate. And I'm very, very strongly of the opinion that either pathway is equally important. It is about finding the right pathway through for your child. So there's a range of options there. In terms of VET courses that are available at GSG, we have the Certificate 2, the Certificate 3 in Year 11 and the Certificate 4 in Business in Year 12, the Certificate 2 in Hospitality, the Cert 3 in Music, Cert 3 in Sport and Recreation, and this year starting the Certificate in Information, Digital Media and Technology, which has been fantastic. I just want to talk a little bit about VET pathways at TAFE. These are last year's offerings because TAFE offerings have only just come out quite recently. Those TAFE offerings are available on MyGSG. Oh, sorry, beg your pardon. Thank you. Angela's going at me at the front and I'm paying no attention to her. So VET pathways at TAFE. You can see there's a huge range of opportunity for students to pursue their passions, but we do want to know about those students who would be keen to pursue a TAFE course early in this coming term. Some of them are really competitive. So, for example, the Cert 2 Electrotechnology is really competitive, and so we want to be able to set students up to put them in the best position to win a spot in those courses. All of these slides are in the information that has come home to you already. There's also a range of pre-apprenticeships available at TAFE, and again, we want to know early if your child is interested in those. Just in terms of looking at a VET pathway, I spoke earlier about students or some VET options. I spoke earlier about us encouraging students to do an English. We want them to pursue their maths. The Careers and Enterprise General is a fantastic way to set them up for the workforce. So this student has complemented those with a Certificate 2 in Hospitality. They're doing Outdoor Education General and Workplace Learning, and you can see that that will flow all the way through. Just a word on our certificate courses. The certificate courses are available either as standalone, that means the students will just, and I did this very stupid hip joint thing when I was doing the presentation on the video, but I think it works in terms of wrapping our heads around how it works. Students may like to do the certificate course just at school. So they will just go and do Certificate 2 in Hospitality, and it's a class on their timetable, and they show up and do that each of the days that it's timetabled for them. Then there is also the opportunity for them to do a certificate course with the term that we call industry specific, which means we wrap around a work placement experience for the students. And that means that they would be out of school in that work placement experience for a day a week. So they will be at school for 4 days a week, they will be in their workplace for 1 day a week. When we start talking about students being off campus for a day a week, we need to be really conscious that they can manage the rest of their workload and be seeing their teachers often enough. So some of that is informing what it is that we're able to offer in terms of combinations. So this student is doing that model. If we move to a student who might be doing a TAFE placement, what we see is English, Maths, Careers and Enterprise. This student's going to pursue a Cert 3 in business. They've also decided that they would like to go to TAFE and they're going to do childcare. That attracts also a work placement for them. So for this student, they are out of school 2 days a week. They are in at TAFE 1 day of the week and they are in a workplace for 1 day of the week. And so it's really important for those students, that those are the students who might come and say, I think I want to do an ATAR course as well because I really like human biology. And we say, no, it's not a good idea. So for example, some of our students might be out on the days that they would have a double period of a subject. And that sometimes falls because we don't have control over the TAFE days and TAFE organised work placements. Sometimes they're missing 2/3 of that course. So we know with our general and our certificate courses students can cope with that, but if we start getting into ATAR courses, it's too difficult to help them pursue that pathway. So that's this model here. Let me just keep noodling along here. This model is also fantastic and starts with a student being in the workplace, so English, Maths, Careers and Enterprise, Outdoor Ed, Cert 3 Business. And what we look for in the first instance is a work placement for them. So this student would go into a workplace in a business context, for this particular circumstance, would go in a business context. And what we do is work with ATC WorkSmart. And for those students who are interested in pursuing a school-based traineeship, this is an opportunity for them to be out of school 1 day a week in a workplace and completing units of competence towards that certification on the same day. So they're out 1 day of the week and they're able to pursue achieving a school-based traineeship and they get paid money. So there's a few faces in the audience when I talk to the kids who go, pardon? But this really hinges on them being in a workplace and doing a good job so that they are attractive to be employed by an employer. So that's something that we think is a super opportunity for them. This student is on a general pathway, and so they have decided they're not going to do any certificate courses, and this is a new opportunity that has only become available in the last year. So students who don't want to pursue a certificate course can do general courses here at school without engaging in that vocational landscape. So that's another option for them. And one of the things I would really like to be really clear with you about today is that all of the people that will be working with your child to help them make their decisions have your child's best interests at heart. And sometimes that means having some hard conversations about, we just don't think this is the right pathway for you to pursue at this point. So to give you an example, I have had conversations with families in the past who will come back to me and say, I really, really want my child to do an ATAR pathway. They must do an ATAR pathway. It's really, really important to us. And I sit with them and I say, well, let's just have a look at how they've gone by the end of year 10, not halfway through year 10, but by the end of year 10. And so here's a student who wants to do maths, apps, ATAR in year 11. And I'm obviously not going to identify the person, but has got 19% on their year 10 maths exam. And the same story across each of they have done, they just haven't been able to engage with that curriculum. And it's so then it becomes about, well, why are we pursuing this? Because all that would happen in that circumstance is that child is set up to fail at every hurdle. And we have in the past had families who have insisted, and we've started, and those students have come up against 20%, 40%, 20%, 19%, and I can't look at them because it's just soul destroying for them. So I guess what I want to do is say the professionals that we're working with really are about making sure that we've got your child's best interests at heart. I also spoke to the students about, and those of you who have heard me speak about this will have heard this before, there isn't a magical fairy who will study fairy who will come and dong you on the head over the Christmas holidays between year 10 and year 11. And the number of impassioned pleas I've had about, but I'll be so much better next year, I promise. And it just doesn't happen, much and all as we'd love it to happen, it just doesn't happen. And Vic, who is our maths specialist, has even modelled this with lots of maths in terms of the data about the way that students achieve in year 10 going into year 11 and into year 12. We do not ever see anybody make tremendous gains in that time. So I just want to be really clear about that from the outset. So go
on. Could I just make one observation on that as well? It used to be 10 or so years ago that if you gave up ATAR in the end of year 10, that was it. You couldn't go to university. And so that was a really big deal. But of course, the landscape has changed dramatically. We won't deal with a lot of that tonight, but there are all sorts of ways to get into universities without doing a straight ATAR. The ATAR pathway is the most direct, the simplest, that's the one we recommend, but it doesn't mean if you take your child out of ATAR courses, they cannot go to university.
Thanks, Mark. Yeah. So please have a look at the prerequisites in the handbook. They are not something that we've magicked up. It is those prerequisites are decisions that we've made very carefully based on years of data, and they are based on the advice of the people who are running those courses. The vast majority of the teachers that you will be talking to about this decision-making process are teaching those courses in year 11 and 12, so they know what it looks like in terms of the requirements. So what will happen from here? The students will receive in their school email account, which Vic will send out tomorrow. There's a soundtrack that goes with that. The students will receive an email which will invite them to indicate to us their preferences. And we need to be really clear about language here. The students will tell us as a school what it is that they as a cohort are interested in doing. And this changes from year to year. And in fact, the school timetable is built entirely around the choices that the year 10s are making for year 11. It dictates the whole rest of the timetable for the school. And so some years, so one year we thought we were fantastic and we were going to offer a new offering and we thought health sciences would be the way to go and off we went and we got exactly this many takers. And we went, right, that's probably not going to run then. Go back to the drawing board. So what tends to happen in that preferences round, if you like, is that we get a sense of what students are interested in. This is the time that we think, yes, we will run two chemistry courses because there's enough interest. Or we need to have two outdoor ed courses running because there's enough interest. But it is not the point at which, and I think this is where sometimes the students get in their head, right, I've made my choices and that's what's going to happen. Okay? And so we need to be really clear about this. So what will happen is that, and I've spoken to the students and I hope that they have taken it on board, we want to see their preferences. Do you want to do outdoor ed more than you want to do certificate two in hospitality? And very often people put English right at the bottom of their list because we're making them do it. Do you want to do chemistry more than you want to do physics? Do you want to do certificate three music more than you want to do physics? Yeah? So that's really important for the students to get those preferences right. Vic takes all of that information then and develops the grid, which we have a version of here. Now, this is only for illustrative purposes. This is a grouping. Each of these columns represents a grouping of subjects which will be on at the same time in the timetable. So, for example, on line one, you can only choose, that's the first column, you can only choose one thing, because otherwise you might end up trying to be in human biology and cert to hospitality at the same time, and that's not going to work. So this, the formation of this is based on the indication that students have given us about what they would like to do. It won't always work, and there will be circumstances and which work very hard to make that happen for as few people as possible. But there will be circumstances where students, and my daughter was one of those last year, there will be circumstances where students are going to have to make some hard decisions and say, I really, really want to do economics and I really, really want to do modern history, but they're on at the same time. And so you need to have some decision making about how you want to get as close as possible.
When do you release that?
So that'll come out.
So the preferences are due at the end of week one next term, and then from those preferences I will create the grid that suits this group of students.
Yeah. And then that will come out to you at home, like come to students, and will come out to you as parents. And I also pointed out to the students the other day that when they finalise their decisions, they need to get your approval for that, they need to get your signature. We have in the past had very funny circumstances, and again, you may have heard me tell this story, but we've had quite funny circumstances where the kids will come with their form and move it around a lot and go, Mrs. Franklin, I'm going to do outdoor ed instead of physics. Okay, here's my sheet. Bye! And disappear into the distance, and then I get said sheet and it doesn't have a parent's signature on it, and I ring home and say, I'm just wondering, was there a conversation about outdoor ed? And I get, what? On the end of the phone. So we try to make sure that you know what's going on as much as possible. Once this is released, we do a lot of work with students about, they will meet individually with their heads of house. You are more than welcome to go to those meetings. And for boarding families who might be watching at home, we will also make times for those meetings to happen, and we can do it over the phone, we can do it Teams meetings, or you're welcome to come into school. So that happens at that point. This is what the students will see when they get this email. If you get a child who comes home and says, Miss Turner sent that email to everybody else in the whole school except me, chances are that didn't happen and we can send you another copy. So please let us know if that's the claim tomorrow. So the students will fill in that form. They will get a receipt. Oh, sorry, thank you. They will fill in that form. Let me stop and let you have a look at it. It's pretty straightforward. But there are also a whole lot of rules that sit in the background to save students from themselves. So there are rules about not being able to do maths methods and maths applications, for argument's sake, that sit in the background. We did have a rule last year that was about you can't do English and literature, and they have removed that rule this year, at which point there was much rejoicing from some of the students, so they can now do English and literature and have that recognised. Some people just pouted and said, that's more English and that's too much, so we don't care anymore. This is then the receipt that will be produced, which we ask you to sign. It is a piece of paper. If you are a boarding family, it's totally fine to produce that at home, take a photo of it and send it in to us, or just email and say, I do hereby approve of my child's choices. And then we get into these sorts of conversations. So I'm sorry I've blathered a lot, but I'm hoping that that has answered, it's I think dealt with most of the questions that are on my list here in front of me. There's a whole lot of silence online. We've got our YouTube live thing. I haven't exploded the internet yet. I was very sad when I spoke to the kids the other day and I said, how many people have watched that amazing video I made? And about three people went,
She didn't go viral.
No, that was very sad. So are there any questions from the floor?
Who's the best person to contact in terms of guidance for a vet path?
This wonderful woman here, Angela, has been doing a lot of work in this area. We have been really working on our vet program over the last little while. It is a changing landscape, and there's always opportunities that are coming up that we want people to be aware of. So please make a time to see Angela.
Sure.
Give her a buzz. Her contact details are in this presentation, and she's more than happy to help, as are heads of house. So they all have that information.
Why would someone choose general over vet, like certificate pathway? What's the, I'm confused about.
It is a good question. I don't.
There's only so many vet qualifications that are allowed to count towards your WACE, and so that's why you will actually need general pathway, because the vet turns into a certificate point rather than a C grade that Emma was talking about. So you need a minimum amount of C grades, which a level 2 vet certificate won't give you. To complicate it, level 3 is an updo, but we won't go down that one to complicate this. But basically it's because you have to have C grades. Yeah.
So there's a lot of rules that sit in the background.
With the example of the courses you had before, you had a Certificate 2 in Hospitality in Year 11 and 12. Does it take you both years to get the...
It does. And so that's important. We're able to result them with the units of competence, and I'm sure Angela will hop in here if I'm getting this wrong, but we result them for the units of competence. So it's broken down into about 12 units, I think. They will walk away with those competences in those units, and they can then go and pick up the remainder elsewhere, so they can do some of those units elsewhere and complete the certificate later.
Mm-hmm.
But if they walk away from it, they won't get the you have finished certificate 2.
Yep.
They might have achieved 8 of their 12 competences for argument's sake.
For hospitality, there's hours associated to it. They have to do a certain number of functions, and that can't all be done within the 1 year, within the time zone.
Okay.
And so that's why Certificate 2 is very definitely a 2-year course. Certificate 3, Sport and Rec, it's 15 units. Again, it's very definitely a 2-year course.
Yep.
You did see Certificate 3, Business.
Yeah, and then Certificate 4
and option. So that is when you have a one-to-one conversation as to the different pathway you may want to take, where we would have a conversation with the parents and the students about what is it they're wanting to achieve, to decide on what that one is.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
If a student is following a VET pathway, but there's an ATAR subject that is a recommended prerequisite for university entry down the track, can they try, and if timetabling works, to do that ATAR subject, or can they not do any ATAR?
They can try. It depends on a whole range of factors about meeting prerequisites.
Mm-hmm.
It depends on whether their VET pathway takes them out of school, and that would be a deciding factor. So that's very much about a one-on-one conversation. Again, with Angela, your dance card's going to get full really quickly. So again, have that conversation. We're open to looking at those combinations, but we also, again, I've seen some students, doesn't happen for all students, but I've seen some students who say, I'm just going to give it a go, and as a teacher to continually be saying that was 25% and that was 30% is just...
No, the marks are there now, but it's just it is a recommended prerequisite one unit.
Perfect.
For entry into what the best pathway
is
going to be.
We can absolutely have that conversation, definitely.
Okay.
Talk to Angela.
With the ATAR pathway, and you said they take the top 4 as your result, it doesn't have to be English?
Correct.
Okay, so that's changed from the old days, but then to get into a unit, that's where the university will base it. They would have had to pass English though?
That's right.
Yeah,
so they need a minimum 50 scaled score, so that is after they set their exams.
Yeah.
They need that scaled score to meet the requirement.
But it doesn't have to be
in
their top 4.
Or they can sit the stat test, which is a literacy test.
Okay.
Later. Yeah.
And if they choose to do English Lit, can they still just sit the English exam, not do the...
They can, but again, that's something that we would need to have a conversation about. That's probably Vic or I, to have a conversation with us about that, because there's a range of, not complications, but just things that we need to deal with in terms of enrolling them as a private candidate and a whole lot of stuff around that.
Okay.
We don't recommend it, to be honest, because I think that if they're doing English literature, they have to do that exam regardless to complete the course.
Yeah.
So, and we've had students do it before who we don't see any gain for.
Mm-hmm.
So,
So, back in the day,
olden
days.
where I come from.
You know, I remember you used to have to do certain subjects to get into certain courses at university. So, from what I can hear, most of that's not valid anymore.
Absolutely.
Is there any particular courses that they must do?
So what we'll talk about shortly, early in next term, there are prerequisite courses for very, very few university courses now. So back in the day, you know, people would say, if you're doing medicine, you have to do chemistry, and you know, and fill in the blanks here, all sorts of scaremongering about you must do. A lot of the universities, in fact, most of them, have gone to a broad undergraduate degree and then specialisation, and that the university will require that specialisation as they come to the end of their degree. So there are very few subjects, bar engineering, actuarial science, and two or three others, that have you must do maths, methods and physics or whatever. Those are all listed on the TISC website, and we'll send you some information about that. But very, very few of them have a prerequisite. Yeah. They'll have recommendations, absolutely, but they won't have you cannot start without.
And if you don't have it, a lot of the universities then suggest you take it as one of your units at university. So it's not even a bridging, it's actually even one of the units that you would pick in your first semester,
right,
so that you're getting still the knowledge base.
Mm.
I'm just very conscious of time, because as the music staff are making faces at me in the background about, we want to get on with it. So they're about to get their cane out. Thank you all very much for coming. Please keep in touch with us. There's plenty of people who are here to and want to help you and your child make some fantastic choices. And please don't hesitate to be in touch. If I could ask you, and I know this is a major pain, but if I could ask you to depart the hall so that we can sanitise everything again and then get sorted for our next event tonight. So that would be great. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Oh, this way. Sorry, beg your pardon. If you could make your way out.